your life, your health, your network. You're listening to Voice America Health and Wellness.
It's going to be a fine night tonight. It's going to be a fine day tomorrow. It's going to be a fine night tonight. It's going to be a fine day tomorrow.
Welcome to Live, Love, Thrive, featuring your host, Marla Mervis. This show will bring you insight and suggestions for flourishing on a daily basis. Now, here's your host, Marla Mervis.
Welcome to Live, Love, Thrive. My name is Marla Mervis, and today we're here to jumpstart your creativity. We're going to be exploring our creativity and how we can get into that flow of creation and really get those juices flowing. And to help us do that today, we have as a guest Sark, Susan Ariel Rainbow Kennedy, and she is a transformative teacher and leader for over 25 years. She's written and created 15 best-selling books and hundreds of products, and she is a founder and CEO of Planet Sark. And her company creates products and services to support empowered living. And I was introduced to Sark years ago when I received a book called Succulent Wild Woman. And when I read this book, actually, when I just picked it up, I swear it just like oozes with energy and joy. It's very colorful. And when I read the book, it was like, wow, someone really finally gets me. There's that essence of like just permission to be myself. And it was when I read the book that I discovered that succulent is my favorite word. It has been since I read this book, and it is to this day. And let me just read you some of the topics that Sark speaks about in her book. She talks about dressing to please yourself. Be rare, eccentric, and original. Shout, I'm here, I'm succulent, and I'm loud. Invent your life over if it doesn't feel juicy. Make more mistakes. Weave into your life a net of love. Paint your soul. And to me, those things mean succulent. And so let's use this word, let's use this idea of succulence today and turn that into our affirmation of the week. I am a succulent wild woman or man. I am a succulent wild man. So what does succulence mean to you right now? Succulence means to me is like sucking the juice out of every moment. And really having that full expression of who we are. So take a moment and just close your eyes and take a nice deep breath in and exhale gently. And I want you to sense, visualize, and imagine yourself in your full succulence. Maybe you're going back to a moment in time where you felt very deep and rich and juicy and whole. Or maybe you're thinking about a time in the future where you want your succulence to just fill out and fill up the space around you. So breathe into that moment and fill up your body and your soul and your mind with succulence. And repeat or say with me, I am a succulent wild woman, or I am a succulent wild man. That just brings a smile to my, this brings lots of smiling to me right now, just saying that out loud. So now, without further ado, let's introduce to you Sark, the succulent wild woman herself. Welcome.
Thank you, Marla. I loved that. I was in such a deep meditation.
Oh, good. Good, good, good.
Yes. And let's remind everyone, too, that succulence includes the shy parts. So you don't need to just be loud. You can be shy and succulent, and you can be quiet and succulent. And a succulent is a plant, as you know, but a lot of people don't realize that a succulent is a plant that nourishes itself from the inside. It gathers water and saves it and gives itself water. So it really is a metaphor for how we can nourish ourselves and give ourselves the love and the juice and the joy that we're looking for, and we don't need to be dependent on the outside to give us that.
Yeah, you say about being inwardly outrageous.
Yes.
And I like that idea, and it's really just honoring who we are, all aspects of ourselves. And I'm glad you brought up that the point of being shy, because there's such succulents in that, in quiet times or quiet movements or manners and ways of being. There's such fullness in that.
Look at the tiny smile on Mona Lisa.
Yeah, and she is succulent, isn't she?
Yes.
So I'm very happy to have you here today and just to share with us some of your tools on creativity. And you recently wrote a book, Juicy Pens and Thirsty Paper.
Yes, gifting the world with your words and stories and creating the time and energy to actually do it.
Hmm. And as I'm reading through your book and just, gosh, underlining and marking different places in the book, you know, it is for writers, but I feel like it's so much more than just that.
Yes, it was always, you know, it's so funny because my books have always been challenging to categorize, and because they really are life books.
Yes.
You know, so there was a lot of talk about, oh, this goes in the writer's section, and then people were saying, but it's really more, it's about writing your life, even if you're not a writer. Even if you don't think of yourself as a writer, it really, we're all called upon to create our lives, and or we have the opportunity to create our lives. And so, yeah, I love Juicy Pens, Thirsty Paper for all the people.
Yeah, because I think you could just take the word writing and add something else to it, whatever, like you said, whatever it is that you're creating.
Mm-hmm.
And I find that, you know, a lot of people who aren't necessarily writers or artists, some people don't actually think of themselves or as creative, or there's not really need for it.
Oh, it's you know, our culture and our society is one of the only ones that divides people up into the creatives and the non-creatives, which doesn't even exist. But
it's so crazy.
It's crazy. And, you know, in a culture like, I'm always reminding people, in a culture like Bali, everyone is thought of as an artist. And your art may come through cooking. It may come through childcare. It may come through something with wood. You know, there's every kind of definition. Everyone is thought of as creative. And I am just one of the people that is shifting, is involved with shifting that belief system. You know, parents are the most creative people we have.
Yeah, absolutely.
And if, you know, that, but it's not thought of that way. And I'm very interested in participating in the shift so that we'll be thought of that way. And you notice, it's funny, Juicy Pens, Thirsty Paper, it doesn't say anything about writing. It says gifting the world with your words and stories. So,
absolutely.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's interesting you said just about being a child, because I know children are some of our best teachers when it comes to creativity.
Oh, yes. I mean, following a child, you know, a lot of people are spending time leading children, but if you follow a child, you will learn so much about creativity.
And you had mentioned in, I don't know which book it was, because I've read all of them, I believe, just how when you were a child, you were always looking for ways to be creative and, you know, asking, you know, do we have to have the chairs all lined up?
Oh, yeah.
Up?
That was in, I think,
line?
The Inspiration Sandwich or Creative Companion. Yeah, I stood up in first grade and said, do these chairs have to all be in rows? And wasn't a popular question, but the teacher actually wrote a letter to my mother about it because she was so astonished.
What, was it a letter of, please have your child stop this, or was it a letter like...
No, she was great. She was very touched and amused, and she started a program where, and I wrote about this in Juicy Pens, she started a program where if you read a book a day, the first child to read a book every day for a year would win a clock. And I was obsessed about winning the clock, and so I read a book every day, and I've continued that to this day.
You read a book every day?
Yeah, pretty much.
Oh, my God.
I read more and faster than anyone I know.
Wow, that's so impressive.
I just came home. I just got back before the show. I just got back from the library with 26 library books.
Wow, that's great. That actually has been one of my New Year's intentions, is to read more.
Oh, do you love to read?
I do love to read. And, you know, it's lots of times it's time. But when I'm reading, I just, gosh, I just get into people's stories, and it teaches so much. I like to read actually right before I go to bed.
Yes. It's a wonderful time.
Yeah, and it just kind of brings me down, even if it's just a chapter here or there.
Yes.
So I find myself in many different stories, reading many different books at the same time, which is kind of fun.
You probably remember this from another book that I wrote, Inspiration Sandwich, when I lived in Paris in the bookstore.
Yes.
I was in Paris and lived behind purple velvet curtains inside the bookshelves, and the only requirement was that you had to read a book a day. And I thought, finally, I qualify for something. And the bookstore is still there, by the way, and it's still presided over by, he's in his 90s now, his name is George, and he's at the Sylvia Beach bookstore in Paris, so I think he's planning to have a successor for when he dies to take over, but it's the most fantastic bookstore, and I lived there for 2 months.
Oh, it's just like right behind the bookshelf?
Yeah, there were ladders and, you know, well, it's a whole very funny story, which I won't tell the whole thing, but when I walked in there, I was probably 19 years old, I didn't speak any French, and when he saw me, he handed me a cigar box full of French money and said, here, take care of the bookstore, I have to go. And so I was standing suddenly behind a bookstore in France, you know, selling books, which he left me there for 6 hours by myself. And when he came back, I thought, oh, you know, thank God he's back. And then he said, hurry along to the rare library and serve gingerbread and tea. Hurry up. There's people waiting upstairs. And so I went up these crooked stairs, and here were these people in rocking chairs and this loaf of gingerbread on the breadboard waiting to be cut. And,
oh, my.
Oh, there's so many stories about that bookstore.
You need to write a book about the bookstore.
Someone did. Someone wrote a great book. It's called Time Was Soft There.
Ooh.
It's the story of the Sylvia Beach bookstore.
Great. So we're going to take just a moment here, and we'll be right back with more from the goddess of creativity, Sark. So stay right where you are, and we'll be right back right after this.
A fresh look at today's health. Voice America Health and Wellness.
Do you take time to take care of yourself? Experience the heartfelt work of Marla Mervis. As a living light Reiki master and licensed massage therapist, Marla approaches each session by connecting the body, mind, and spirit, creating a relaxing and holistic experience. Marla is dedicated to empowering others to heal themselves physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Learn these techniques for yourself as well as others. There are Reiki classes to those interested in becoming a Reiki practitioner. To find out more, visit her at www.marlamervis.com. There are many ways to find health and well-being, and the most powerful force within all healing is love. Loving energies are the unifying force for self-healing and healing others, releasing stress and finding balance in your everyday existence. With love and compassion, we can create and achieve anything we set our minds to, but we need to first take care of ourselves. Marla Mervis, healing at the speed of love. For more information, visit her at www.marlamervis.com. That's www.marlamervis.com.
Opinions, options, answers. Voice America Health and Wellness.
It's going to be a fine night tonight. It's going to be a fine day tomorrow.
You're listening to Live, Love, Thrive. Are you looking to have a fulfilling life? Do you have a question or comment about today's show? Marla wants to hear from you. Call in toll-free at 1-866-472-5792. That's 1-866-472-5792. You can also send your questions or comments via email to mmreiki6@yahoo.com. That's mmreiki6@yahoo.com. Now back to Marla Mervis.
So if you're just tuning in, we're here with Sark, author, writer, and humorist, and she has many upcoming events and workshops, and she does speaking engagements all over the country, all over the world, Sark?
Yes.
Great. And she has some legendary writing workshops that she is going to be doing upcoming here in February. She is doing Juicy Pens, Thirsty Paper in Scottsdale, Arizona on February 7th. You can find her in Mountain View, California, February 20th and 21st. And also in North Hollywood, California, March 21st and 22nd. And the way to go and check this out is you want to go to planetsark.com. And I tell you what, if you go to planetsark.com, just know that you're going to be there for a little while because it definitely keeps you there. There's so much fun stuff on there, Sark.
I know, isn't there? Did you ask Jupiter a question? That's my favorite. I had the most magnificent black cat named Jupiter, and before he died, he asked if he could be an avatar and be able to inspire people. So he channeled all these answers to me, and I wrote them down, and we fed them into the computer. So there's a photo of him, and you can click on him and ask him a question, and he's uncanny in his answers.
Oh, that's so fun. That's great. And then you also have your inspiration line.
Yes, I've had the inspiration phone line for 15 years. It's a free service where there's just a toll charge, but many people now, of course, have cell phones and unlimited long distance. So it's 415-546-3742. And if you like words, it's 415-546-EPIC, E-P-I-C. And it's me singing, reading poetry, talking. It's about four to 5 minutes in length, and I change it about every month.
I listened to you this morning. All I need is love.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and I get about 10 or 12,000 people that call every month from all over the world, and I get the great privilege of listening to all their messages back to me. So I feel so blessed and happy to hear from all the people reading my books and creating their own books, and it's a great synergistic transpersonal experience.
And, what a way to give and receive.
Yes, and I have always felt that I write for the collective unconscious, so I feel like I'm hearing from people, and that feeds into my unconscious, into my dreams, and lets me know what I want to write about next.
And you do create a lot from your dreams.
Yes, I do. Most of my book titles, Juicy Pens, Thirsty Paper, came from a dream. Succulent Wild Woman came from a dream. I just had the most fabulous dream 2 nights ago. I dreamed I found F. Scott Fitzgerald's typewriter.
And where did you find this?
Well, I don't know, but it was in some kind of old room, and I came and I found it, and it was kind of larger than usual, and it had these wooden sides. It seemed very odd, and as I started, I got brave enough to type on it, and as I started typing, the sides fell down and revealed itself to be a race car. It was a wooden race car, and I got in it and drove away.
Wow. So I love dreams.
I know, don't you? And so I'm writing my memoir right now, and it's been kind of scary and challenging, and the dream was a great affirmation to, you know, to really keep driving, keep going.
Well, dreams are great too because they remind us of actually how creative our minds actually are.
Yes.
When there's no holds barred.
Yes. Yes. Of course, now I'm looking for the car that's going to, I mean, I'm looking at every typewriter like, is that my car?
I know a lot of my creativity and a lot of answers comes to me right before I'm ready to go to fall asleep.
Yes.
It's like
true,
when I
isn't it?
Let go of everything, and it usually happens when I've been working on something all day and I'm kind of in a tizzy over it.
Yes.
And I'm trying to create something, and I'm kind of pushing against it.
Yes.
And then as soon as I let everything go, put my head down, all of these thoughts, words, images, whatever, and I'm like, get up right now, go write it down. And when I do, it's beautiful.
Yes, that's a really good thing to remind people of. That, and also sometimes people are not remembering that they can write down requests for their dreams. Before you go to sleep, you can write down a question or think of a question and say, dream, please bring me the answer.
Mm.
It's very successful and powerful.
It is powerful. We do have so much power, don't we?
Oh, yes. We're much more afraid of our power than our weakness.
Yeah. I do believe that. In one of your books, you talk about being too much.
Oh, yes. Fear of being too much. Yes.
The too much society. I don't know how many...
yeah, then I said, let's form a society. Write and tell me if you've ever been told you're too much. I think I got about...
Oh, my gosh. I have been told I'm too much. I'm too emotional, too sensitive. My clothes are too colorful. Can't you just put a pair of jeans on? I think that was the latest that I was told. And I had like some wild, like bright yellow pants on. It's like, can you just wear something normal?
Yes, those are the people that get scared. Oh yeah, and I was writing about how someone said I was laughing too loud in a restaurant, and the manager came over and told me this. And so I said, I stood up in the restaurant and said, "Can I see a show of hands of people who think I'm laughing too loud?" and no one raised their hand, so I said, good, the matter is settled, and I sat back down.
And did you continue laughing as loud as you can?
Yeah, well, I was laughing mindfully. I mean, there is a way to laugh and disturb people's meals, and there's a way to do it, you know, there's a way to have exuberant laughter without disturbing people.
Yes, I agree. But it is interesting how the older we get, I just did a show a few weeks ago about laughter yoga and how...
Oh, I love laughter yoga.
It's great. And it just reminded me when I was out, I was at some work. I dance a lot, so I go to these dance classes, and these girls were just laughing hysterically, and I was totally in a different space. I was, like, very inward and just, you know, experiencing a lot. And my first thought was, this is really inappropriate. You're not supposed to be laughing right now. And then I just like, wow, I just really had to look at that and just say, you know, laughter is so important, and it is. It's just, it should be everywhere.
Yes. And of course, people being mindful of other people, if someone's in an inward space, you know, perhaps you can move a little bit at a distance, or you take it to the other room, or... You know, there are ways to be mindful and laugh exuberantly.
Absolutely. And just remind ourselves that bring it on. Bring on the laughter.
Yes. I think I find most things quite hilarious. And my parents did also, which were wonderful role models for laughter. And we had great family trips that consisted of a lot of laughter. Well, there was a lot of yelling, too, but there was a lot of laughter because most things are funny.
Yeah, they are.
I mean, I'm writing a grief book right now, and I'm writing about the humor in death, because as both my parents died, there were many funny things about their deaths. And it's almost thought of, as so irreverent, almost blasphemous, to write about the humor in death. But yet everybody knows it's there.
Yeah. Well, I think that, you think about the movies that are out there, you know, the what they call them, serial comic movies. Some of the movies I've watched, I'm like, am I really laughing at this?
Yes.
And they're some of the funniest movies because
Yes. They're
really, they get you where it hurts, kind of, and then they create all this laughter around it, and it just kind of opens up the possibilities for expression.
Yes.
Yes. So let's talk a little bit about different things we can do when we're in a creative process. You said that you don't like to consider things deadlines. You like to think of them as finish lines. And I thought that was great. I had to do a lot of play on words myself.
Well, especially when you find out the origins of the word, the origin of the word deadline came from prisons, and it was where they drew the line, and if you stepped over it, you were shot.
Yeah, we don't need any deadlines.
So we don't need deadlines. So, yeah, I call them completion dates.
Completion dates.
Because you probably know that I invented this method to have completion in my life. I had been such a procrastinator and perfectionist, I invented this method called micro-movements. And it was specifically designed for myself with a short attention span and procrastinating. I wanted to get so many things done, but I was never, ever completing anything.
Mm.
So I invented this method so that I could have what I call a habit of completion. Because procrastination is really just a habit of not completing.
There's so many distractions around us, too.
Right, and also most of us are very creative and excited, and so we assign ourselves things that are too large, but we don't realize it at the time. Like we say, oh, I'm going to write in my journal every day for a half an hour. And that sounds reasonable. Until, you know, the third day when you write for 15 minutes, and then the fifth day when you write for 10 minutes, and then the next week you can't locate the journal. And then pretty soon you wonder why you bought another expensive journal. And so it's, you know, real life enters in. And so micro-movements are what I invented so that I could have a real life and still accomplish all my creative dreams. So it's just incredibly simple. It's just something I'm always reminding people to do much, much, much smaller movements. So it's 5 seconds to 5 minutes in length, and you just... you can do them one by one, and then I also, in the Juicy Pens book, I have a more advanced method, which is using a wheel. And you write down a date and time, which is very gentle, and a lot of procrastinators resist this because they're busy making plans and schedules with everyone else, but they don't make it for themselves, for something that they really want to do. So I always remind people it's a gentle date and time. So this is not a motivational system. This is not a goal-setting thing. This is just a gentle way to accomplish and complete things that you want to do. So my favorite example is a lot of people put clean their closet on their list. Let's say they have a list, but then they never do it because they really don't want to clean their closet.
No, who wants to clean their closet?
No one does. So you write down Friday, 2 p.m., open the door to my closet. Now, obviously, that's very simple, but you may open the door to your closet, and that may be all you can do. Like, you may take a look and say, oh, it's just as bad as I thought, and you close the door. Or you might look and say, wow, I didn't know that, you know, I'm going to take that box down, I'm going to take that piece of clothing out, and before you know it, you've gone 5 hours and the closet is cleaned. So micro-movements are merely I call them an ignition device. So they're like a little accelerator, a little ignition device. And then you can choose another one. And that one might be Monday at 5 o'clock, take 5 pairs of shoes off my shelf of my closet and look at them.
And Sark, I'm going to have you hold off 1 second here with our micro-movements, and we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to pick off right where we left off, right to this.
Sure.
Opinions, options, answers. Voice America Health and Wellness.
There are many ways to find health and well-being, and the most powerful force within all healing is love. Loving energies are the unifying force for self-healing and healing others, releasing stress and finding balance in your everyday existence. With love and compassion, we can create and achieve anything we set our minds to, but we need to first take care of ourselves. Marla Mervis, healing at the speed of love. For more information, visit her at www.marlamervis.com. That's www.marlamervis.com. Do you take time to take care of yourself? Experience the heartfelt work of Marla Mervis. As a living light Reiki master and licensed massage therapist, Marla approaches each session by connecting the body, mind, and spirit, creating a relaxing and holistic experience. Marla is dedicated to empowering others to heal themselves physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Learn these techniques for yourself as well as others. There are Reiki classes to those interested in becoming a Reiki practitioner. To find out more, visit her at www.MarlaMervis.com.
Your life, your health, your network. Voice America Health and Wellness.
It's going to be a fine night tonight. It's going to be a fine day tomorrow.
You're listening to Live, Love, Thrive. Are you looking to have a fulfilling life? Do you have a question or comment about today's show? Marla wants to hear from you. Call in toll-free at 1-866-472-5792. That's 1-866-472-5792. You can also send your questions or comments via email to mmreiki6@yahoo.com. That's mmreiki6@yahoo.com. Now back to Marla Mervis.
And welcome back to Live, Love, Thrive, and we're here with Sark, and we're just in the middle of talking about a tool that she is teaching us called micro-movements. And Sark, would you like to finish us off? I'm ready to clean out my closet.
Well, yeah, let's give another micro-movement example. Someone might want to go to Europe and paint, and their micro-movement might be Saturday, 5 o'clock, take my passport application out of the drawer and fondle it lovingly. Mm. So, it's a way to continue. I don't talk about progress. I talk about process. So it's a way of continuing the process of creative living, because I designed micro-movements so that we could continue to live and procrastinate and be perfectionists and still accomplish and complete creative things. So I've written 15 best-selling books, and all of them exist only because of micro-movements. I wouldn't have done any of them. So I do work with people showing them how to do micro-movements in their life, and I will be at the different workshops February 7th coming up in Scottsdale. I'll be doing a whole day of Juicy Pens, Thirsty Paper.
And more than just the workshops that you do, you're actually starting to work with people individually. Is that correct?
Oh, yes. I'm launching a new service in February. It has elements of coaching and therapy and mentoring, yet it's none of those things, yet it has elements of all three. So I realized it needed its own name. So in a dream, the name came to me, which is Couching. So it's Couching with Sark, and we'll be announcing it in my early February e-letter and on Planet Sark. So to working with individuals by phone, couching.
And I recommend to everyone to go to Planet Sark and sign up for the e-letter. I know we get a lot of e-letter stuff and stuff in our emails, but I think it's really great. It's really fun, and you know, your books are so colorful, and I swear they're not like a book. I feel like they should be squishy.
You feel that what?
Your books should be like squishy, not actual books. They just seem like they have so much more than just like the normal paper.
I love that.
I don't know if you can create that, but that could be something in the future.
Yes, the future book.
The future book. Squishy.
Yeah.
And you do all of yours. You handwrite all of your books.
I do handwrite all of my books, and I do all the art. And, I love the handmade, I love handmade art. I just love it. And I was really inspired as a child by comic books. So I love the marriage of words and art. And I was very lucky in my family because our parents let us read at the table. So we would have any number of kids coming over from school at lunch, and we would have like an 8-foot-tall stack of comic books on the table. And we'd all be silently reading, eating our grilled cheese sandwiches.
Oh.
Yeah, reading was a high value in my family. I'm so grateful for it.
I know my sister was always, my younger sister, she was like reading Les Mis, Les Miserables at a really young age. And I we were just like, what? And I remember one of her teachers was like, I don't know what's going on here. Your daughter's reading this, you know, really intense book and she's so young. And my mom was like, bring it on. That's
good
great.
For you, Mom.
Yeah, my family's been, you know, I've been very lucky because I think having a great support system around you is really, really, really valid. And I've been a creative, my mom said I came out of the womb dancing and singing. And I've always had a great support system behind me in all of my endeavors, my acting endeavors and everything along the way. And I know that when it comes to creativity, surrounding yourself with supportive people. And I think you talk about that in your book as well, Juicy Pens and Thirsty Paper.
Well, yeah, and I talk about how important it is to educate people around you how to be supportive if they...
Oh, my gosh! That's so true.
Yeah, because some people don't know, and I remind people that sometimes family and friends are the last ones to tell about your creative dreams. Because if they haven't been educated, they often will react like an inner critic. They will often react like an outer critic. They'll say things like, well, have you really thought that through? Oh, you're going to really be able to make any money with that? And they'll say all these kind of things that can really crush dreams. So it's really important to be able to tell people, okay, I just started a book and I feel really scared and I could really use some support and encouragement. I'm not looking for critical thinking at this time. I just want you to embrace the idea of me writing a book and celebrate with me. And people will really give you what you want if you tell them what their job is. If they don't know what their job is, they'll just say what they think they should say.
And that's so important to hear and to really learn, because otherwise you learn the hard way, and I've learned the hard way many times.
Well, yes, and also sometimes people really put their dreams on hold for many, many, many years based on these sometimes thoughtless things that people say because they just don't realize the impact.
Right. I know. I remember I had a friend of mine, and I worked on a project. I'm like, can you go and listen to that? And he listened to it, and he thought that I wanted him to, like, study it and critique it. So he came with, like, a large list of paper saying, you know, I would change this, I would do this. I'm like, no, you're just supposed to say I'm great.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I remind people, I often tell people, especially a new creative dream or offering is like a little baby. And we don't take the baby out in the carriage and show it to someone. We don't take our actual physical babies out. People don't criticize them. No one leans over and says, wow, he has a really big head and strange hair. Have you thought about getting his ears done? You know,
mm-hmm.
Nobody's doing that. Everybody's leaning over. Oh, look at the cute baby.
Right.
You know, and there's a time for that. And sometimes, you know, there's time for critical thinking, too. And there's time for saying, I need some feedback, which might not be easy to hear. Let me tell you what the best way for me to receive that is. You know, it's just important to know what you're looking for, know how to ask for it, and help educate the person that's involved in your support circle.
And what kind of words of wisdom would you give to our own inner critic?
Well, I always recommend the work of Hal and Sidra Stone, who started a whole body of psychology called voice dialogue. And I recommend them so highly. And they've really learned the art of dialoguing with the inner critic, because the inner critics are really there just to protect us. And they've grown out of proportion. So they get too large, and their whole thing is to say no to everything and be scared of everything. And so if you, you know, at first it really takes time and practice. So don't start trying to dialogue with them if you haven't read any support material. But the best way is to use what's called red energy. If you can imagine your hand slicing down into the air and saying very loud and then very intensely, no. And that's the energy you use when those inner critics get too loud. I mean, because they will come and stop everything.
Yes, they will.
And then I'd like to remind people the other powerful thing that I use is to give inner critics new jobs, because inner critics just need something to do. And I send mine to other countries. Like, I have a whole squad of them in Iraq right now, because there's a lot of work to be done in Iraq. And, I have some on my roof that just sweep gravel, because there's a lot of loose gravel on my roof. And so if you can keep them occupied, they won't be in your business the way they will be if you don't give them new jobs.
And it's important just to keep moving, right? To keep...
Well, I always tell people, do anything you can do to get past the inner critics. Lie to them, trick them, distract them, and run, whatever it takes, because, they live with us. They live within us. And I really love voice dialogue because it helps you know what the different critics are and what they need. And most often, they just need to be heard. And sometimes we're so busy trying to crush them that they can really grow larger because of it.
Yeah, I know when my voices get really loud in my head, that's exactly what I want to do. I just want them to stop. And they're not going to stop.
Well, no, it's the famous thing, don't think of a pink elephant. And then all you can think of is a pink elephant.
Right.
So when we want them to stop, they will literally, it's the exact opposite that's going to happen.
Yeah, so I like to put it up on the shelf lots of times. I think I'm like, okay, so this is what I'm thinking. I'm just going to put this over here, and then I'm going to go and finish up, my creative work or whatever it is.
Yes.
I'll do that, and maybe I'm sure I'll come back to you at some point.
Yes, yes.
But for right now,
can
you just hang
one.
Out over there?
Yes, it's a perfect one.
Yeah.
I think I wrote about this in Juicy Pens. I said that I'm almost feeling sorry for my critics now because they're getting kind of old and ragged. And they're kind of shuffling up to me with all of their old words. And I'm like, oh, here they are. I feel sad. But they're also very wily.
You're going to die soon. Yay.
Yeah, well, and there's a saying about inner critics that they know everything. They have an IQ of 400. I mean... They literally take everything that you're doing, like if you're listening to this show, they take everything that you're doing and basically find a way to try to protect you from it.
Hmm.
So it's very powerful. It's very important to know about the inner critics and to do your work with that.
Right. So we're going to take a quick break and come back with Sark in just a moment.
A fresh look at today's health. Voice America Health and Wellness.
Do you take time to take care of yourself? Experience the heartfelt work of Marla Mervis. As a living light Reiki master and licensed massage therapist, Marla approaches each session by connecting the body, mind, and spirit, creating a relaxing and holistic experience. Marla is dedicated to empowering others to heal themselves physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Learn these techniques for yourself as well as others. There are Reiki classes to those interested in becoming a Reiki practitioner. To find out more, visit her at www.marlamervis.com. There are many ways to find health and well-being, and the most powerful force within all healing is love. Loving energies are the unifying force for self-healing and healing others, releasing stress and finding balance in your everyday existence. With love and compassion, we can create and achieve anything we set our minds to, but we need to first take care of ourselves. Marla Mervis, healing at the speed of love. For more information, visit her at www.marlamervis.com. That's www.marlamervis.com.
Your life, your health, your network. This is Voice America Health and Wellness.
It's going to be a fine night tonight. It's going to be a fine day tomorrow.
You're You're listening to Live, Love, Thrive. Are you looking to have a fulfilling life? Do you have a question or comment about today's show? Marla wants to hear from you. Call in toll-free at 1-866-472-5792. That's 1-866-472-5792. You can also send your questions or comments via email to mmreiki6@yahoo.com. That's mmreiki6@yahoo.com. Now back to Marla Mervis.
And we are back with Sark. It's been such a pleasure having you here with us today, Sark.
Oh, I've loved it, lived it, and thrived it.
You are the loving, living, and thriving woman, the succulents yourself. So I just want to remind everyone about Planet Sark and about your upcoming events, like I said, so you can go to Planet Sark. And in your workshops, you're teaching people about how to let your stories and words...
Well, it's really, it's gifting the world with your words and stories and creating the time and energy to actually do it. So we do a little exploration of what stops you, what starts you, and then I really utilize all the tools... micro movements and other tools to really show people how to leave. People leave with a guidebook that they've created at the workshop, which they will be able to use throughout the year. And then, like I said, I'm offering coaching with Sark, which is a combination of mentoring therapy and what was the other one I said? Coaching.
Of course, along with all this stuff, there's going to be lots of fun to be had.
Oh, it's always very fun. There's always a lot of laughter. It's introverts are especially welcome. I myself am an introvert. You might not be able to tell, but
really,
yeah, the introvert is just someone who needs to get alone to replenish their energy. So, I really welcome, because sometimes my work can get miscast as kind of, loud and laughing all the time and. And that's fine. Some of that definitely goes on, but it's definitely on the deeper, more intimate side, as well as humor, which we know can be very deep and intimate.
Well, I think that your work is about cultivating all the moments so that you can live big and luscious if that feels right to you. I mean, you talk a lot about napping and taking care of yourself and getting quiet so that you can be, replenished and be a channel for other people.
Well, absolutely, and my big focus right now and what I'm working on is it's called the Love Sandwich, and I'm working on it's more of a program than a book, but it's about how to love someone else and love yourself. So self-love is a big part of I'm not finding it taught enough or talked about enough, and I'm very excited. I've been practicing myself avidly for the last 3 or 4 years, and I'm just finding such great stuff, and so I'll be bringing that self-love work to the writing workshop as well.
That's
just
great.
Like you said, it's definitely about a lot more than just writing.
Yeah, I mean, that's a lot of what I talk about is self-love. I teach Reiki courses, and that's really what it's about. It's about taking care of ourselves and loving ourselves so much and loving others around us so much that we want to take care of ourselves.
Yes, and that, I'm sure you know, too, I talk about, if we're all full cups, who are spilling over, that spillover is what we can share with other people in the world. It's so much richer than if we're not filled up.
Hmm. Thank you so much for being with us today, Sark.
Oh, I've loved it. It's so fun.
Yeah, it's been a lot of fun to have you here. And everyone, go to Planet Sark. Give her a call, 415-546-3742. Go to that inspiration line and you'll definitely be inspired. So thank you for being here and best of luck to you, of course, and much success.
Thank you so much, Marla. I've loved it.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye.
Bye. And now today we're going to do our great giving segment, and this is an organization called Center for Creative Voices in Media. So keeping with the theme of creativity, and this organization is a nonprofit
that's dedicated to preserving America's media, the original, independent, and the diverse creative voices that enrich our nation's culture and safeguard its democracy. Now, in this organization, they have tens of thousands of artistic professionals that are giving life to our nation's popular and literary art and entertainment. But the ability of these creative artists to do their best work has been severely compromised by excessively concentrated media ownership. Because when independent creative voices are locked out of that marketplace by what they call as gatekeepers, not only are the artists harmed, but so is the public. And creativity can be sacrificed in honor of making money. And in our country, we have five media conglomerates that control over 75% of primetime viewing and also own 80% of cable companies. And this media concentration can cause some harm. So freedom, democracy, and culture require a vigorous competition among many competing ideas, voices, and points of view. So the Center for Creative Voices believes that the public interest requires restoration of a vibrant marketplace of ideas, full of competing and diverse voices and vision. What they also promote is creative freedom, and they fight against government censorship. Our nation's democracy and culture depends on the fullest and freest expression of ideas, and government censorship of media content violates the First Amendment and causing an unacceptable chilling effect on creative expression. The Center of Creative Voices also has many other key issues that they're dealing with, such as areas in open broadband internet access, the impact of digital TV, and also in regards to national cable ownership. If you'd like to engage in other activities and learn more about them and support their mission, I invite you to go to creativevoices.us. And this is Center for Creative Voices and Media, and they're really doing their best to safeguard us and just let the creativity and all media to really flourish. So check out creativevoices.us. And now I'd like to leave you with our sacred sound segment, and it's an album called Learning to Fly, and the song is called Heaven Down Here by the artists Tuck and Patty. I wish you a wonderful, succulent, beautiful, juicy day, and may you just cultivate such joy in your heart, and may that joy overflow and reach out to all of those around you. Have a great day. May you live, may you love, and may you thrive.
You can offer your soul to an altar of sacrifice, but give your heart to me. Let's bring heaven down here. Let's bring heaven on down. I don't want to wait for the angels. Heaven, oh.
Thank you for listening this week to Live, Love, Thrive. Your host has been Marla Mervis, and we'd love to have you join us again next Friday at noon Eastern Time, 9 a.m. Pacific Time, on the Voice America Health and Wellness Network. Have a wonderful weekend.
It's going to be a fine night tonight. It's going to be a fine day tomorrow. It's going to be a fine night tonight. It's going